Right, so I'm talking here with Benjamin Moser, who's just put together a series of new Clarice Lispector translations for New Directions. And so I guess the first thing I'd like to start with is just where this all came from. Just if you could really quickly take us through how these translations actually got to be new translations.
Well, I fell in love with Clarice Lispector when I was about 19 years old, when I was in college, and I happened to fall into studying Portuguese at Brown, where I had gone to start studying Chinese, which was my big idea, that I was going to study Chinese. I was really excited about it. I took this class in high school about Chinese culture and everything. And Chinese, unfortunately, turned out to be completely, hopelessly impossible. And after a few weeks, I just thought, after the professor told us that it would take 10 years to read the newspaper, that I really needed to find something else to do. And so what I did was happen into Portuguese, which was the only class that was still open at the time. And I spoke Spanish because of my background a little bit. And I found that Portuguese was actually pretty easy to learn, which was a big difference with Chinese. And the first writer that we met in this class, you know, after about three semesters, was Clarice Lispector. And I just never got over her. And I really, really, really wanted her to achieve the readership and the prominence that I thought she deserved, and that a lot of Brazilians think that she deserves, and that she occupies. You know, the place she occupies in Brazilian culture is really hard to compare, I think, with anybody in English language culture. People always ask me, you know, who would you compare her to? And it's different because she's not just somebody that people are interested in or read or study, you know, like Hemingway or Faulkner, or, you know, people actually are in love with Clarice Lispector, and I was one of those people. And I had this sort of missionary urge with her that would have probably embarrassed the hell out of her. But I started thinking, even when I was 19, I started thinking, like, how can I help this person reach the prominence that she deserves? And finally, about 7 or 8 years ago at this point, I was sitting in my garden here in Holland, and I was talking about this thing, and I said, you know, what am I supposed to do? Like, what? And I was sitting here talking, reading this book of hers that I'd read for the 12th time or something. And I thought, God, this is so good. You know, I read this when I was 19. I read it when I was 25. I read it when I was 30. And it's still so good, which is not always the case. Some writers, you know, really hit home at certain times in your life, and some don't. So somebody said to me, a friend of mine said, well, you know, there's this festival starting in Brazil tomorrow. Why don't you just go? And I said, you know, you're right. So I got on a plane the next morning to Sao Paulo, which was one of those moments of spontaneity that you have sometimes in your life. Sort of like when you meet somebody that you fall in love with and you sort of make a move on them, and it's really scary. Sometimes it works out and sometimes it doesn't. But this one worked out, and I went to Brazil, and I started writing a biography. I just thought maybe that was the way to show her who she was. And that was a book that became Why This World, which was published in 2009, which was published in many countries in the world, and especially in Brazil, where it became a really big hit, to my huge relief and satisfaction. Because I thought, you know, why do they need some guy from Texas to tell them who their greatest writer is? But they thought that was really interesting and sort of charming that somebody from Houston was writing about Clarice Lispector. And, but the problem was with this whole thing is I always said, I can talk about her as much as you want, you know, where she came from and how she grew up and her work and blah, blah, blah. But the point was, most of her work was not really accessible in English because it was either untranslated or, with a few exceptions, it was badly translated. And it was a real problem for me because I would say to people, you know, you've got to read this. This is so great. And then I would say, actually, wait, never mind. You know, either you learn Portuguese or you don't, or just don't worry about it. And so luckily, I thought, well, if I do this biography, somebody's going to be interested enough in her and realize how important she is and want to republish her stuff. And New Directions, under the stewardship of Barbara Epler, who is one of the finest people in publishing, said, let's do it. And even though they already had a lot of these translations in print, and as I'm sure you know from working so much with international literature, It is very rare for a writer to get one chance in English, a non-English speaking writer. You know, I mean, that is something that Chad Post knows, that you know, that all these people know. It's hard. You know, most people are not interested, for whatever misguided reason. Publishing people are often scared of translation. And so for a writer to get one chance in English is a big deal. And for a writer to get two chances in English is pretty much unheard of, unless your name is Miguel Cervantes or Dante Alighieri or somebody like that. So we started this, and now I've published just now The Hour of the Star, which is Clarice's final work that she wrote when she was nine in 1977. And next year, in conjunction with New Directions and Penguin Modern Classics in England, are going to be publishing four more of her books. So I really think that this is going to be a great chance for her. I hope.
So I definitely want to get into the whole aspect of retranslation and talk about this book. But before that, I want to go back to your biography. This is something I think a lot of people in the international literature world, particularly in the United States, have a lot of questions about. I mean, as you say, it's a very rare thing for someone outside of U.S. publishing to get this kind of acclaim, especially a difficult author who hasn't been in wide circulation for quite some time. How did you get so much attention for this book? How did this actually catch on to the point where people were willing to retranslate her?
Because I'm really obnoxious. And
is that what it takes to succeed?
I am so pushy, and I didn't realize this about myself, but when I was doing this book, I was convinced. I thought, this writer is so incredibly fantastic. She's so good. There's got to be people who know about her. I mean, you know, you can't be this good a writer and not and be totally unknown. And because it was sort of all I talked about for 10 years, still here I am talking about it. When you travel and you talk to people and you meet people, every, you know, 1% of those people are going to be interested in her. And for example, this first book has a preface by Colm Toibin, who is one of my very favorite authors. And I met him at this wedding just by coincidence and started talking to him. And that's how I found out that he was really interested in her. And so I would just recruit these people and sort of not let them walk out of the door until they had signed away their first born to me. Because I thought that the way that you get attention for somebody like her is to get people who are already known to get behind her. You know, she's dead. She's been dead for 33 years, and she can't speak for herself. So somebody needs to sort of shake. I don't know. You know, I just kept pushing because I just knew I was right. You know, I thought, come on, people. She's so incredibly fantastic. When I was doing this thing, I was like, if I don't make this work right now, then there's not going to be another English language biography of her. Actually, it was the first English language biography ever written of any Brazilian writer, which is pretty shocking when you know how fantastic Brazilian literature is. But, you know, I mean, Brazilian literature, you could say that about a lot of literatures. You could say that, I'm sure, about Polish literature or about Indian literature or about Chinese literature. I mean, I'm sure there's lots of people that are fantastic that aren't known.
You know, I think you definitely touch on a good point. A lot of times the authors in translation, either they're already dead or for various reasons, maybe they don't speak English, the costs of bringing them out here, they can't really have or be their own champion as you can get with domestic writers. And a lot of times, by default, the translator ends up being the champion. I mean, what do you think about that? Obviously, you didn't mind playing that role here.
I liked it because I'm a missionary. And I thought it was kind of a challenge. And the more I realized, I don't know. You know, she was Jewish. And I'm partly Jewish. I'm half Jewish and I'm half Texas. I'm actually all Texas, but my mother's family are descended from these very rough people who conquered this incredibly hostile part of the world in the 19th century. And I felt my old sort of Texas Jewish blood coming up in me. I loved the challenge. I love that everybody was saying, you can't do this, nobody cares, nobody's ever heard of this woman. And that just, it was like a red flag in front of a bull. I can't tell you any other way. But I just thought, these people are wrong. They're all, because so, I got so much negativity about it, you know? I got so many people telling me I was wasting my time, I was no one's ever going to publish it, no one's ever going to read it, no one's ever going to review it. And I just thought, they have to. It's so incredibly great. They can't look at this incredible woman and not realize how important she was. So, I mean, it was stupid, actually, if I think about it. The fact that it all worked out was great, but, I mean, that was a pretty much, I don't know how to say it. It was lucky, basically.
Yeah, I think you've just expressed just about how every person who's ever been involved with pushing translated literature has felt. I mean, it's great that you have that kind of determination, I think, in large part.
There's a lot of English language writers like that, too.
Oh, sure. I don't mean to say it's just an aspect of
translation. Translation has a particularly high hurdle. And it's hard. And, you know, I feel really lucky that this one worked out. I don't want to push my luck and try another one, you know?
Yeah. Okay. So let's go to Hour of the Star for a second. So you were talking before about the previous translations of Lispector not being quite so good. And I was curious, I'm assuming you must have been talking about the Giovanni Pontiero translation, which was previously available for Hour of the Star. Anything in particular that you felt that wasn't working with that or that you thought should be changed in a new translation?
Well, quite a lot. You know, Giovanni Pontiero actually did something that everybody who's translated her has done, including a lot of the people that I've been editing, because, you know, I translated this one and I'm editing the other ones. And I see Clarice Lispector is a very strange writer, and she doesn't write proper Portuguese at all. Her whole syntax, her vocabulary, it's all very weird. And actually what I wrote in the post-fast, or whatever you call it, the afterword of this translation of The Hour of the Star, was that when I published my biography in Brazil, five different copy editors, Brazilian copy editors, went through the book, and they all tried to change her prose because it just doesn't sound right to Brazilian. And a lot of Brazilians actually find her difficult to read, even though she shouldn't be for us. You know, I mean, if you speak Spanish or French and you don't really know Portuguese, but you kind of flip through the grammar and you sort of see that, you know, a word that ends in C-I-O-N in Spanish will end in C-A-O in Portuguese, you know, those kind of things. You can read her pretty easily. But a lot of Brazilians find her difficult because the way she rearranges her sentences is so odd, and it's really surprising, and it's, you know, it's what makes her a poetic writer. And so basically people want to change her. And Pontiero, for example, tried to sort of fill in the lacunae that come up in her work, which are many, and try to sort of smooth it out and try to make it more readable than it is. And actually, the thing about her is it is very readable, but you just can't try to put it into a mold of a standard of standard grammar and syntax.
Yeah, and but reading the translation, your new one, it's a very readable book, and that's what I found with Lispector. Even the previous translations, they're very readable, but I feel like they require a lot of attention because she's doing things with structure and syntax that aren't generally done, and you'll gloss over them, or it's very easy to miss what's going on, or just to kind of get absorbed in other thoughts while you're reading these books, I've found.
Which is actually part of, she probably wouldn't have objected to that, you know, I mean, but because she sort of writes as a mystic. I mean, she's trying to unearth something that isn't actually in the words. It's between the lines, and it's between the words. And that's what's so interesting about her in a lot of ways. But as a translator, you know, you can't fill that in for other people. You have to let other people take their own journey, as it were, you know, and take their own, make their own connections. And so that's a lot of the problem. A lot of the other problems, you know, a lot of people don't know Portuguese, and that is a really stupid thing to say, sound apparently. But in fact, you know, a lot of translators of Portuguese in America, particularly, are Spanish speakers. I mean, are not Spanish speakers, but people who first learned Spanish and who see Portuguese basically as a strange dialect of Spanish.
Mm-hmm.
And you see that a lot. You know, you see a lot of words that because, you know, I live in Holland, Dutch and German are a lot like Spanish and Portuguese. You know, you can sort of figure out the one if you know the other. But it's a very deceiving thing. And some of the translations have been okay, but the problem is Clarice has a very, very distinctive voice in Portuguese. I mean, there's no one that sounds anything remotely like her. And so my job, I think, in editing these translations has always been to make them all sound like each other, whatever that is, you know. But so that people at least get one voice out of it. I'm working with four translators now. Two of them are American, and one of them's English, and one of them's Australian. So already there, you know, that's a big challenge in terms of making them sound sort of like each other. And but it's really fun. You know, it really, I think it's such a lucky thing to have happened, because I really believe that once people read these books, they're not going to be able to not know how important she was.
That's an interesting point you raised about there being a number of different translators working on the other books and mm-hmm. having to bring, I mean, Cesar Ayra, who's one of my favorite writers from the Spanish, has a kind of a similar situation where he wrote a number of very short books and they've right. been spaced out over a number of translators. And I guess you're probably right. It's hard keeping that distinctive voice sounding right among all these people. What do you see as being the plus sides of having four different people working on one writer?
Well, you know, I mean, it has good sides and it has bad sides, because I would say the good sides basically is because of Penguin Modern Classics in London, we have to have all these translations done by next April. I mean, published by next April, which is a big challenge, and it's not something that New Directions usually does. So, you know, I mean, it's quicker if you have different people working on it. But also, one of the things that I, being probably misguidedly idealistic about translation stuff, is I wanted to work with younger translators, because I thought that it was really important that we train a new generation of translators, not just from Portuguese. I mean, in this case, it's Portuguese, which is a very, very underrepresented language in terms of qualified translators. But I wanted to sort of, you know, get more people involved, because I think that a lot of times, and I didn't want to be this person, I still don't, you know, a lot of writers end up being owned by one or two people, one translator, one professor, one reviewer, you know.
Yeah, that's very true.
Yeah, so I thought, I mean, I'm a democratic person, I thought that it would be fun to work with younger people, and I hope, I mean, maybe it's not going to happen. But I hope that we can kind of help bring to some prominence some translators who, you know, I mean, there's the thing about Portuguese language literature, Brazilian literature, is that there's not that many opportunities to translate really great writers. You know, I was a translator from Portuguese because I learned Portuguese in college. And then for years, you know, I translated these detective novels, which are actually pretty fun. You know, they're good detective novels, but it's pretty rare to get an opportunity as a young translator to translate a classic author. And I think it teaches you a lot, and it forces you to learn a lot. So that's what that was a little bit of my reasoning.
You know, that makes a lot of sense. I mean, just from being in the field, I think there's a lot of feeling that it's good to help enable one another, because ultimately we're all representing the same kind of thing here. If you help give a young translator a leg up, then you're helping the field in general, because those people can go on to produce more translations. And I see a lot of that. So I think what you're saying there makes a lot of sense.
Because there's a lot of prejudice against all of us, you know, as people who are involved with international literature, I think there is prejudice against it. And I mean, at the same time, there's also a lot of respect for it. I think that a lot of people really think for other people. This is what I've seen in publishing a lot, is that people think, oh, no, people aren't going to like this, even though I really like it, but nobody else is going to like it. Whereas my sort of approach, what I was telling you before about, like, this is so great, it can't not be understood by people. I think it's a real opportunity to kind of bring people together around something that's pretty great. And, you know, if Clarice Lispector becomes widely read, like other people like Roberto Bolaño or like Jorge Luis Borges or like, you know, all the other García Márquez, you know, there's not that many Latin Americans that actually have a wide readership. I mean, that's probably it. I probably just named them, actually. Jorge Amado, maybe, even though I don't think people really read him anymore. But I think that the more people can get involved in these things, the better, because everybody has their friends and their, you know, a lot of these people teach as well. So
yeah, I totally agree. So I want to ask you a little bit about Hour of the Stars, since that's the one that you did, and that's the one they just published it in November. So it's, as you said, it's her last book, and sometimes last books can be a little bit of a different sort of thing, or a difficult entrance into an author. Do you feel like this is a book that someone who doesn't know her can pick up?
Well, that's funny. It's an interesting question, because you're right, actually. I never thought about it that way, because it was the first book of hers that I read. And it's a book that she writes when she's dying. And it's her first, for example, it's her first explicitly Jewish book. And it's not really explicitly Jewish. It's explicitly Jewish in the sense of the character, the main character, Maccabiah, has a Jewish name. She's named after the Maccabees, who are the heroes of the Hanukkah celebration and who are the people who keep their own individuality unto death. But I read it when I was a sophomore in college, and I hardly knew Portuguese, and I thought it was the most powerful and beautiful thing I'd ever read, probably. And it is quite unlike a lot of her other work, because it's very, very explicitly storytelling. You know, I mean, she was a famous short story writer. A lot of her novels are very difficult, though. They're very mystical, and I mean, we'll see. I'm going to be really interested to see how people react to some of the other books, because some of them are kind of either you think it's the greatest thing you've ever read, which is my case, of course, or you don't understand any of it, which is the case of a lot of other people, including a lot of people who are not stupid, you know, people who know a lot about books.
I've even had the experience in some of her books of going from one to the other right in the middle of the book.
Yeah, because it's like, it's tough. A lot of it's tough, you know. I mean, she's a very difficult writer sometimes. But this one, I think, is her most accessible novel, and I think that it's the book that, I mean, I know it's the book that ensured her fame in Brazil. She announces her death in it, and then a few weeks later, I don't know, after it's published, she gets in a taxi, and she goes to the hospital and basically dies. And I think it's an incredibly moving book, and whenever I've given it to people now, you know, some people didn't really get it in the old translation, which I understand. But luckily, the people who are seeing it now, or at least that's what they're telling me, maybe just to be polite, are very moved by it, very impressed by it. So
yeah, I found it strangely moving in parts. She can really, so it has this central character, this young girl, and she really goes in and out of her life. I mean, there's the obscure mystic aspect, but then just in a few lines, she can kind of take you into this person and make it suddenly very moving. I mean, it really goes in and out of that, like few books I've read have.
Well, and especially, I think, for writers, I hope some writers will be listening to this. I assume they are, because of the nature of your sight and everything. She talks a lot about the hesitations and the difficulties and the anxieties of writing. Mm-hmm. In a way that I didn't really get, because I was 19 when I first read this, and I wasn't really a writer except as a sort of scribbler, you know, like people are when they're teenagers. And as I've now done this for so much of my life, it resonates with me more and more, which is funny because I read her as a teenager, and often she's known as somebody that either gets you as a teenager or she doesn't ever get you. Caetano Veloso, who's a very famous Brazilian singer and who is writing the introduction to The Passion According to G.H., which I'm very excited about, which is her great mystic adventure. He read her when he was 17. He was just writing me this the other day. He read her when he was 17 and he never got over her. And now, you know, Caetano is probably 62 or 63. So, you know, it's something that really follows you through your life.
Yeah, there's definitely that gripping adolescent angle to it. I see that, but I can see how it's a book that you can grow with as you get older. I also, I wanted to ask you about a particular aspect of this book. It has 13 titles that Clarice gave to it in addition to Hour of the Star. Could you talk a little bit about those?
Those are funny because one of the funny things, I actually put this in the book. If you see behind the title page with the 13 titles, I reproduced the actual mock-up, the publisher's mock-up of those titles. And Clarice was wounded very severely in 1966, so 10 years before this book. And she almost died in a fire that was caused by her falling asleep, taking sedatives, tranquilizers, and smoking in bed. She fell asleep with a cigarette, she woke up, and she almost died as a result of the fire. And so her hand was very wounded, her right hand, and she mainly typed. But if you see her late handwriting, it's very shaky, like an old woman, even though she died when she was only 56. And here, in the middle of these titles, you have this signature that is, I don't know what it cost her to make the signature, but it's her perfect old handwriting. Because she, in this book, she writes as a man, which she does in most of her last books. She writes in the masculine, you know, which is very easy to see in Portuguese, easier than in English, because all the adjectival endings, you know, reflect that.
Right, it's a gendered language.
The gendered language, which English isn't, so that's sort of harder to see. But she gives us all these titles, 13 titles that come up, and you look at this when you first open the book and you think, you know, sort of like when you see a title of a book before you read the book, it doesn't really mean as much to you until after you've read the book. But these are 13 titles that she weaves through this book in these very ironic ways. And one of them is point or period as for the future period. And I got very upset with the Brazilian publisher because they left out the initial period in the current edition of The Hour of the Star in Brazil. So it should be point as for the future point. And they just did as for the future with no point, no period. Mm-hmm. And she says, at some point in the book, she says, there are periods on both ends because eventually you will understand the importance of delimitation. And it's kind of funny. I mean, some of these things you don't really see, but as you're going through it carefully, do when you're translating it, it's very subtle and it's very funny a lot of often. You know, it sounds very grim to say, oh, this is her last will and testament, and she was dying, and she was in a fire, and all this kind of stuff. But actually, The Hour of the Star is very funny, and it's very ironic in a way that I think people who are familiar with Jewish literature, especially, if you've read Kafka, if you've read Isaac Bashevis the singer, if you've read Isaac Babel, you know, these kind of people, there's this sort of gallows humor to it that that I think is pretty funny. And I think, you know, because Brazil is a country that doesn't really have very many Jews. The Jews in Brazil always understood this, and other people didn't always understand it because they weren't really tuned into it as much. But now I think they are starting to see the parallels.
So I wanted to also ask you a little bit just about the process of translation of the book. This is something maybe translators will be wanting to know about. Are there particular resources or things that you rely on when you do this book or other books?
Definitely. There are two things that I would say about it. One thing, and I think this is a personal hobby horse of mine, but there's a dictionary by a guy in California in the 50s called James Taylor, and it's a Portuguese-English dictionary that's fantastic, and I don't even know if it's in print, but it's a very interesting and very complete dictionary. It's particularly fascinating because it covers the whole range of Brazilian flora, which is, as you know, as you suspect, an incredibly complicated part of the world because the Brazilian natural world is so important. But that's a fantastic dictionary. And the other thing that I love is, and every translator loves this, I think, is wordreference.com, which has dictionaries for about 30 or 40 languages. And not only that, but it has insane grammar nerds sitting on there all day, anonymously, wherever you are in the world, waiting to answer your question. So you say, like, I'm not sure about this construction. And you instantly get 25 emails. You know, it really is one of those things that makes you, as a grammar nerd myself, it makes me feel less alone in the world. And it's really fun. And you also, by asking these questions, one of the nice things about it, and one of the nice things that you can only do on the internet, is it builds up the database, you know. So if you have a question about a word, then 5 years from now, someone else who's thinking about that same word can see these conversations. And it's really a fantastic thing, word reference.
Yeah. It's
on the top 500 sites on the internet. I always thought it was my own little secret, but clearly not.
Yeah, that sounds like a very nice thing. I read a lot in Spanish, and there's always phrasings and such that I need to actually look at what a native speaker thinks of these things. And it's nice, too, to have a database kind of build up over time so you can see the language changing or just kind of see what people are interested in.
Well, it's also nice that when you read about the world as it is today, which is sort of depressing and miserable in so many ways, just the idea that there's all these people that are just sort of waiting around to help people that they don't even know in countries they've never visited. And it's kind of nice, you know, it makes you feel supported. And a lot of the thing about being a translator is that I'm sure most translators experience this. It's a pretty lonely job. You know, you're kind of sitting there with a dictionary. That's pretty much your job. And suddenly, you know, you have this whole community, which is really nice.
Yes. So speaking about community, actually, what kind of places do you look to, or where do you go to discover new things, or just find these authors that you want to bring into English?
Well, you know, actually, I always feel sort of weird. I just thought that when I just answered the last question about speaking in the first person plural about we translators. I'm not really a translator. You know, I'm a writer, and I have translated a lot because for various reasons, personal reasons, I speak languages. And especially languages aren't very common for Americans to speak, like Dutch and Portuguese and things like that. So I don't really, you know, I don't really think of myself as a translator. And because I think that people who are actual translators do something a lot different from what I do. I think that when I'm intervening to my small, pathetic little degree that I can do that in trying to bring an author to someone's attention, when I've done that, like with Clarice Lispector, I've really wanted to go all out. And what I also do is a lot of reading for American publishers and English publishers of foreign books. So I have a lot of people asking me to read books in different languages, and I hope that quite often people actually listen to me, to my astonishment. But
they have to. I mean, it's, you're their eyes and ears.
I guess. Yeah, it's kind of funny. It's a funny responsibility. It's similar to like, you know, I'll have a piece in the New York Times next week about a Hungarian book that that I reviewed, but that's somebody who's already translated, it's already bought it, it's already published, you know, so I can say yes or no, I like it or I don't like it, but it doesn't really, it's already there. And I think that translators, you know, it's a sort of monastic vocation, I think. And I have a whole lot of respect for translators, and I don't really consider myself a translator, even though I am someone who's translated, but I think that I'm very good, I think, at translating Clarice Lispector because I spent many, many years studying her work. But I think a real translator is somebody who can translate anything. You know, somebody who can just say, here's some crazy 18th century poet, go for it. And I think a real translator can do it. And I don't think I can do it. I think I'm good at translating her. But would I be good at translating, you know, like João Guimarães Rosa, who's the other great Brazilian writer of the 20th century. I mean, I wouldn't even know where to begin with him.
Yeah, so. It's a good question of being able to mimic a whole bunch of voices versus being very close to one particular voice. And clearly, I think in your case, it sounds like it's the latter.
Yeah, because, you know, when I studied her, I had writing a biography, a critical biography, you have to sort of make a case for why she's interesting and important, and you obviously quote from her books. And so you have to find a voice for her in English. And I did that. But I think a real translator is somebody who can get into anybody's head. Maybe. Maybe that's optimistic. I don't know. What do you think?
I think that sounds true. I think there's a lot of truth to that. And that's actually a great way to wind things up. I want to thank you for giving us a little time here to talk about Lispector and your various work with translation. I hope you enjoyed the conversation.
My pleasure. It's always fun to talk about her.